And so at Project Censored, we looked at the phenomenon of the reform movement, and in addition to publishing the top underreported stories each year and so on, we've also conducted a good amount of media analysis, from applying the propaganda model to the left progressive press to, you know, critiquing paleo-conservative or right-wing media, also corporate media. So we're kind of at least consistent in the fact that we're critiquing some of these kinds of groups and organizations.
And, you know, again, Bob McChesney, in fact, said the other day on Pacifica Radio that it was a big middle finger to the media reform movement. That's what he said. And I said, that's cool. We were saying that years ago. When we were trying to be constructive about what was going on in the reform movement and talk about the significance of having a more radical approach. And so we think that it's well beyond time to move into, you know, really a more radical trajectory about what news media is, really what it really is, what it can be in a broader basis. And again, at Project Censored, one of the key ways that we do this, we have a radio program each week on KPFA, and we have a new documentary film, annual book, but we're a media education organization. So we believe one of the great ways to reach out and get to people is through critical thinking skills and
radical intellectual activity. And I've developed a working model or definition of how I think we could all probably agree on, more or less, identifying, examining, and publicizing the root causes of major problems in the body politic that hinder the full realization of each individual's human capacities. What are some of the possible avenues or categories where these might be manifest? Well, looking at Project Censored's news cluster might be a place to start. The economy, war, health, and the environment. The viability of the commons, with the example of Iceland, for example, and civil liberties or freedom of expression. Because if we don't have freedom of expression, we can't be radical. We can't be anything, actually. At about the time I was born, Noam Chomsky wrote the essay, The Responsibility of Intellectuals, suggesting that radical intellectual activity along the lines I have highlighted here above is necessary if we are to survive as a species. The late 1960s was a much different world than the one we inhabit today. I think of Jim Garrison's remark that the world is much different in the late 1960s than when he was born back in the 1920s or so. Unlike the 1960s, today we have a police state, militarized police. We have a loss of constitutional protections. We have a war, we are told, that will be without end. And we have huge, glaring economic disparities, never before really seen on this scale. So the stakes that we have are much greater, and so too is our responsibility. There are clear obstacles to fulfilling such a responsibility as a journalist and as a scholar. Now, as a scholar, there are certain things that we can and cannot say, but we nevertheless do have, some of us at least, many of us are scholars here, we do have the security of tenure, I suppose, as a matter of whether or not we use it to the extent to which we wish to. And we are also aware of our the political nature of our positions, given the fact that we are here today. Apart from the academy, the greatest hindrance to fulfilling this responsibility, if we are acting as journalists and activists towards radical intellectual activity, involves the question of surprise. And I thought you probably never thought you'd hear this at a UBC conference, but money, resources, where does it come from? And there is a tendency for progressive media, as well as the media reform movement, to rely on funding from tax-free foundations. And this is no better illustrated than in John Pilger's first-hand account, available here in Censored 2014, with his discussion of his film, The War You Don't See, which became The Film You Don't See, courtesy of the Lannan Foundation, that pulled the rug out from underneath Pilger as he was about to embark on a tour promoting the work.
To play off the last speaker, we did figure out who's been funding Free Press. They're now about $4 million organization, and they're getting money from Ford. Rockefeller, Knight, and a dozen other liberal foundations. And after Minneapolis, some of these groups, like 9/11, were refused tables. They weren't allowed to come. And we, after Minneapolis, had put a proposal in each time and were turned down. So that has raised the question, you know, reform versus radicalism. And Chris Hedges just wrote a piece that's really made me think about this recently. It was entitled An Invisible Revolution, came out this last week, where he's saying that this corporations free from all laws, government regulations, internal constraints, are stealing as much as they can, as fast as they can, and we're on the way down. I think most of us understand that. And so we're shifting to corporate totalitarianism globally. And it's incremental. A little bit more every year, a little bit more every year. To literally, we're moving towards a sort of neo-feudal state of governmental relations. So having that in mind, Hedges is saying that we need radical resistance now. Any just incremental attempts at reform, it's just going to make it worse. Revolt is the only option, he writes. Ruling elites, once the ideas that justify their existence are dead or resort to force, will resort to force as a final clutch of power. So he strongly supports nonviolent non-cooperation as a means of resisting this. He says, but we have to get really radical about it, really resist in some strong ways, or we're going to end up with a fascist world, corporatized totalitarian system. And the more we can understand that and drive ourselves in very radical, shocking directions on any issues that we're engaged in, it's vital, and use every mechanism of communication that we have. If not, we're going to lose it very, very rapidly. Lose citizenship, lose control, literally control the world.
When I say the word secession, what's the very first thing that comes to your mind?
California.
The Bear Flag Republic. That's funny, I never get that answer. Thank you. Must be in San Francisco. You said Texas. Anyone else? Secession. Sarah Palin's husband.
Civil War.
Civil War. Anybody else?
Quebecois.
Vive Quebec. Allons-y. So secession is an interesting term, and we've been exploring it quite a bit in Vermont for the past 7 or 8 years. Typically, when people hear the word secession, assuming that they know what it means and how it's pronounced and how to spell it correctly, which is hard for a lot of folks, the first thing that people will think of, typically Americans, when they hear the word secession is, of course, the Civil War and slavery and the issue of states' rights in the South. And one of the interesting things that we've done at Vermont Commons is to try and remind Americans of their own history. Secession is every American's birthright. The Declaration of Independence of 1776 is founded on the principle of secession. The very first action verb in the Declaration of Independence is, of course, the verb dissolve. Yes, dissolve. And what secession means, of course, is simply to absent yourself as a smaller political unit from a larger one, which is what the English colonies wished to do with the British Empire. In the 1770s. Vermont is in a unique position to lead this national conversation on secession because Vermont is the only state that used to be its own self-constituted republic from 1777, the year after the Declaration of Independence was written, until the year 1791, when Vermont chose to join the United States as the 14th state. Yes, California was a Bear Flag Republic, but it was wrested by force, as we all know, from Mexico. Yes, Texas was the Lone Star Republic. It, too, was wrested by force from Mexico. So we feel in Vermont like we have an interesting history, and we've got lots of skin in the game when we talk about the United States and our involvement in wars on the frontier against indigenous people, and all of that. That New Englanders decided, you know, maybe we're not so hip to all this stuff, and maybe it is time to sort of absent ourselves from this United States. So when we talk about Vermont independence, we're simply going back to our roots as Americans, as New Englanders, and as Vermonters, in thinking about radical responses to United States that I think, alas, is in very deep trouble. And I don't say that with any trace of excitement about that sad fact.
The decimation of human rights in Haiti, the same thing is happening in Palestine, where there are thousands of NGOs, international NGOs, who are there to basically serve their own interests and dictate how Palestinians can organize themselves based on the limitations and structure of the NGO itself. In reporting on, you know, what's happening in Palestine and not having to be beholden to a foundation's own biases or structures with strings that are pulled is actually really important to me. And what can I say about the state of reporting on Palestine in the U.S.? It's a challenge, to put it mildly. I think anybody who has a modicum of radical, not even radical, but even, you know, just a basic, human analysis when it comes to what's happening to Palestinians on a day-to-day basis, Palestinians inside the occupied West Bank or Gaza, or inside what's considered to be Israel, or outside of the diaspora in the refugee camps here in the United States and in North America. I think trying to get to the heart of the issue itself and put it in a context in which it should be framed, where this is a matter of human rights, this is a matter of violations of basic international law, this is a program of settler colonialism and of ongoing ethnic cleansing of white supremacy really at its core.